So, during the next 15 minutes, I will try to present some new data that we're having from our lab, describing, in fact, how resistive breathing, frequently observed in asthma exacerbation, severe asthma exacerbation, or COPD exacerbation, could really injure the lung. For any human being to take a normal breath, his inspiratory muscles should be able to generate sufficient pressure to overcome the lung elastic and chest wall elastic loads, as well as the resistive load. And usually, we have a very great reserve for that. Usually, a human being will use just 5% to 10% of his maximum pressure per breath. This is in normal situation, but in disease, things come a little bit different. Here you have patients that fail to wean from mechanical ventilation, and the same patients later on wean successfully. When they failed, we have the black markings. And you see here this ratio of the mean inspiratory pressure over the maximum inspiratory pressure, corrected for the degree of dynamic hyperinflation. And clearly you see that when these patients fail to wean from mechanical ventilation, they have quite excessive loads. And for instance, in COPD, that is our interest here, you see that the load is actually more than 50% of maximum. And although the data are sparse, a similar thing is happening in acute asthma. Very old study published in the New England Journal of Medicine. They did a challenge of asthmatics, and they have shown that during acute asthmatic crisis, in fact, the average tidal pressure development is more than 50% of the maximum, whereas in normal it's much less. So usually in severe COPD exacerbation or asthma attack leading to respiratory failure, we're having like a 50% or more of the maximum inspiratory pressure generated per breath for the respiratory muscles. So we wondered, is this probably injurious for the lung? And we developed a model of a happy here rat that is breathing through an inspiratory resistance, having a supplementation of oxygen to prevent hypoxemia. And in fact, we are putting here a resistor so that every breath, the animal is able to generate around 50% of the maximum. Here you have the occlusion that you are doing to measure maximum inspiratory pressure. And then we adjust the resistance by putting different sizes of needles so that every breath the animal generates like 50% of the maximum. And we had the idea that this great intrathoracic pressure development, negative intrathoracic pressure development when you're trying to breathe against resistance, might injure the lung. And this could be either a direct mechanical injury or an indirect injury through mechanotransduction. So we did an animal experiment. So we got rats and we made them inspire through resistances for 3 or 6 hours. And we tried to measure the function of the alveolar capillary membrane. What we initially did, we created a technique of nuclear medicine. So the animals inhaled a radio tracer, a DDPA. And this radio tracer goes into the lung. And then it is absorbed from the interstitium and goes into the circulation. And mainly the clearance is determined mainly by the integrity of the alveolar part of the membrane. And here you have the data of a representative 3 animals. Here you have the control data. You see, the more red you have, the more radio tracer stays in the lung, which means that it has not been eliminated, so it has not been absorbed. Here you see what happens after 90 minutes in a control animal. Here an animal has already, before starting to inhale, has already been subjected to 3 hours of resisted breathing, and here to 6 hours of resisted breathing. And you see that, for instance, at 6 hours of resisted breathing, here you see that you have really no tracer or very little tracer. And if you quantitate the whole animals, you see that the percentage of retention is much lower in animals that have breathed for 6 hours. 3 hours is somewhere in the middle. And here is the control animals that have no resistive loading. So definitely, you have an increase in the uptake of the radio tracer, which shows that the alveolar membrane is being injured. Is it only the alveolar membrane? No, we did the reverse. We injected a dye, a blue dye, in the circulation and have try to see what is happening afterwards. And you see that if you take the lungs out and you measure how much dye you have in the lung, after 3 hours of resistive breathing, after 6 hours of resistive breathing, more dye goes out of the circulation into the lung tissue, showing that also the endothelial membrane is also being injured. And is this having mechanical consequences? We use the Skurek machine to measure both force oscillation and to generate PV curves. And in fact, we have very consistent decreases in the mechanical derangements in the mechanical properties. The elasticity goes linearly up and the compliance goes linearly down after 3 and 6 hours of resistive breathing. And the PV curve changes. Here you have the normal PV curve, and here you have the PV curve of the animal that has during inhalation and exhalation that has been subjected to 6 hours of resistive loading. So, does this have any consequences for oxygenation of the animal? Yes, we have a really direct and severe impairment of oxygenation. And if you want to know why, it is because, in fact, you have a huge inflammation in the lung. Here is the lung tissue. Various cytokines go up in a time-dependent fashion. You have a variety of cytokines going up. And you don't have to be really a pathologist to understand that the lung tissue here has significant inflammation, both interstitial and intraalveolar inflammation. You compare the normal with the 6 hours of resistive loading. And if you really quantitate the lung injury using various systems of scoring, you see a really time-dependent increase in the injury you are getting. And there are various pathways that are being activated, molecular pathways of mechanotransduction. You have initially an increase in the SAR kinase. This is a sensitive kinase to stretch. And then you have phosphoERK and NF-kappa-B activation coming later. And you can see here, even immunohistochemistry, you see the more time you have spent on resistive breathing, the more brown it becomes. And this is a signal for detection of phosphoERK in the lung. Now, we have also tried to say, okay, we're trying to mimic a severe COPD exacerbation here, and you get a severe injury in the lung. Do we have any other consequences potentially in the lung? And we have tried to measure stuff that in the lung are important for COPD, like the matrix metalloproteinases that have been shown to be upregulated in the lung in severe COPD. And you can see that in a time-dependent manner, you have a significant upregulation of both matrix metalloproteinase 12 and matrix metalloproteinase 9, both in terms of expression and in terms of activity. You see here a zimography and the actual activity level. So probably this mechanical loading might injure the lung and might start a process of causing further injury by activating various enzymes. This is work in progress. And not only that, you have heat shock protein upregulation, significant heat shock protein upregulation. And why is that important for us? Because, you know, heat shock proteins have been shown to be one of the most important ligands for sterile inflammation. They're able to activate both the TLRs and the NLRs and initiate a sterile inflammation, significant inflammation, with no infectious agent. Is it only an inspiratory phenomenon? We have tried to analyze that, and so we quantitated various loads now in our lab, and we have actually seen that if you do only expiratory resistance, then the impairment you have in the lung is significantly less, and you have to go up to 60% to start seeing problems. But if you do what is normally happening, combine inspiratory and expiratory resistances, and the inspiratory being less than the expiratory, because the intrathoracic pressure usually is positive during expiration, so the resistance is greater during expiration in obstructive airway diseases, then you get a greater degree of derangement. Here you have the compliance, inflammation. So by combining inspiratory and expiratory resistance, you get a bigger inflammatory response. Then we went to see, okay, this is in rats. Is it species specific, or can we repeat that and try to figure some more mechanisms? So we developed in our lab a technique of doing tracheal banding in mice. I'm not having time to give you a lot of these results, but in fact, you have exactly the same thing. If you do like 50% reduction in the surface area of the trachea, You get a significant inflammation after tracheal bonding, and you don't have, again, to be specialist to see the inflammation. And if you quantitate it, it is clear you have a lot of inflammation in the lung. You have derangement of the mechanical properties, the resistance of the tissues, the elasticity goes up, the compliance goes down. And we have some interesting findings we're exploring now. You have a definite reduction in the expression of soluble guanylate cyclase. Why it is important? Because it regulates the tone of the airways. You have a reduction in the expression. And if you're trying to pharmacologically restore that by giving a downstream mediator of guanylate cyclase that you do here, you have a real protection from the problem. Here you have control animals. And this is elasticity. This is compliance. Tracheal bonding increases elasticity. And if you repeat tracheal bonding by restoring pharmacologically the cGMP pathway, you get a reduction in the increased elasticity to control levels. And the same thing is for compliance. And of course, you get also a reduction in the inflammation. You see here the inflammation in the bowel, the number of cells, and the protein, which is a marker of edema, that goes up during tracheal bonding and is being restored by pharmacologically restoring the pathway of cGMP. And of course, it improves also histology. If you either quantitate that or you see the picture, here's the tracheal bonding animal, and here's the animal that has received the pharmacological inhibition. And we have done also now, I don't have the data here, knockout animals not expressing one of the two subunits of cyclic guanylate cyclase, and you have a huge inflammation in these animals. So is it only specific to the lung, the injury that comes upon resistive breathing? We have tried to measure various tissues, and no matter where you go, in the liver, the spleen, the intestine, the kidney, you have no other injuries, not a systemic phenomenon. The only injury you are having is in the lung, is in the diaphragm. The only other, I'm not sure it's direct injury, but the only other changes we're getting is in the diaphragm. Here you have rats that have been subjected to resistive breathing. And its lane represents one animal. These are 3 hours of resistant breathing, 6 hours of resistant breathing. And this is a technique that detects simultaneously various cytokines. And you see that in a time-dependent manner, various cytokines are being upregulated in the diaphragm of animals that have been subjected to resistant breathing. And in fact, if you do immunohistochemistry, the myocytes are the actually the cells that are producing these cytokines is not invading macrophages or white blood cells. And of course, we try to see what the potential mechanisms might be. And we were thinking that oxidative stress might be one of the triggers. And what we did an experiment showing doing resistive breathing in rats. And we gave, before the resistive breathing, N-acetylcysteine to reduce oxidative stress. And you see that all cytokines were significantly less upregulated upon receiving antioxidants from the beginning, showing that oxidative stress might be one of the stimulus for that. And this is not only animal experiments. This is relevant for humans, because if you take humans, normal humans, and you subject them to the same resistive breathing experiment just for 45 minutes, you get an upregulation of the cytokines. And if you give them a combination of antioxidants to reduce the oxidative stress development, and you repeat the experiment, you get no real increase in these cytokines. So to conclude, resistive breathing per se, mechanotransduction in the healthy lung, no previous injury, no ARDS, nothing before, causes significant inflammation, deranges lung mechanics, injures the alveolar capillary membrane, causes hypoxemia, activates various pathways, and probably some of them we have not explored them, I'm sure, decreases soluble guanylate cyclase, and causes a significant cytokine upregulation in the diaphragm, and these cytokines also escape into the circulation. Thank you very much for your attention. Oh, and these are all of the people, my apologies, that have worked for these experiments, and I thank them a lot.
Thank you very much. Very interesting presentation.